call tonight's meeting to order. Good evening, everyone. This meeting of the Reading Municipal Light Department Board of Commissioners is being broadcast at the RMLD office at 230 Ash Street here in Reading, Massachusetts. The meeting is being videotaped for distribution to the community television stations in Reading, North Reading, Wilmington, and Linfield. The RMLD Board of Commissioners recognizes the importance of hearing public comment at the discretion of the chair on items on the official agenda as well as items that are not on the official agenda. We ask that all questions or comments from the public be directed to the chair, and that all parties, including members of the RMLD board, act in a professional and courteous manner when addressing the board or responding to comments. Once recognized by the chair, all persons addressing the board shall state their name and address prior to speaking. It is the role of the chair to maintain order in all public comment or ensuing discussion. Okay, so I'd like to acknowledge some of our participants this evening from our Citizens Advisory Board representative for this evening, Dennis Kelly. Dennis, welcome.
Thank you.
We also have Peter Leidecker from Finance Committee. Thank you, Peter, for coming. And Mayu Sivi from PLM Electric Power. Welcome. John Stenpeck, one of our board members, is unable to attend due to a work commitment. And Amid Jafari is also unable to attend from RMLD staff.
Should recognize Mr. Brown.
I'm going to. Leading up to that thing.
All right.
And Dave Hennessy, will you be our board secretary?
Absolutely, Tom.
Okay. And the distinguished Mr. Bill Brown is here this evening. Bill, I know you're here for public comment, so please come up. Welcome.
On this side of the aisle.
You're among friends.
I hope so. I've been thrown out.
Okay. Thanks, Bill.
Good evening.
Good evening, Bill.
You hear me on TV all right? My name is Bill Brown, 28 Martin Road. Customer number 108508, if you want to know that. That's what they send me on my bill, everybody. Everything. I come down, I was talking to you, Tom, earlier this week, I believe, Saturday.
Yep.
And expressed some interest in getting you guys out of this site and turning it back into some income for the town of Reading. And in doing so, I have a complete list of every piece of property that's owned by the town and the valuation. So that's what I prepared for you people on your land. And right at this present site, you have 8.67 acres and a little under $12 million that it's worth. So I don't know what you feel about it, but I think it's something you should be looking into. Not only for the sake of the town of Reading, but for your operations. Being down at the lowest end of your territory, in the last 25 or 30 years, it must be increasingly difficult for these guys to get from here to thing. And last week there was a pole set next to me. Now I know they have to leave here, go up to West Street, pick up the pole, and then go from there. So that's got to be operationally inefficient. You know? But I just thought you might enjoy this. And then the other thing I was talking to you, Tom, about is the solar panels. I don't know what your policy is, but the town of Reading has the parking lot by the depot from High Street all the way up to High and Vine. And I would think it'd be a great place to put up some canopy type of solar panels, both for you people and for the town of Reading, and help on the peak load. So
good.
Look it over, think it over. I know it takes 10 years to get anything done in this town, so I hope it will be around 10 more years. I don't know yet.
Pauline, I know there's a lot going on in the, you know, the planning stages. I don't know if you have anything you want to comment now in terms of, or certainly we can.
No, I appreciate seeing this. We have been working with the town on that MAPC development that they had done in different economic pockets in Reading. You know, we're waiting to hear if anything happens as well. I'm not sure where that went.
Well, one of the things that they're talking about is relocating their DPW, you know. And given the finances of the town of Reading, I don't think that the taxpayers will go for $20 million debt exclusion to move them someplace else. And that's the minimum price.
Right.
So.
Well, the MAPC economic growth, the drawings, and I think it's still on the Reading, Town of Reading website.
I know.
Showed the Reading light still on this property.
Right.
But the whole property developed with mixed use and actually I thought it looked, I thought it worked really well. We had talked to them about how the trucks would egress and we would be very interested in having economic growth out back.
Yeah.
But there are multiple owners, so.
Well, I'm just talking your property without there, you know. I liken it to going down and buy a Big Mac. I can't put the whole Big Mac in my mouth at one time, despite what some people may think. You can only take one bite. And quite frankly, given the history of Metropolitan Area Planning Council, I wouldn't put much faith in them. And unless you know the history of them, they're left over from the old Metropolitan Area, Metropolitan District Commission established in the 1930s. So they don't have any power to do anything. They just, they like to plan. And then when that fails, they plan something else. So their history, as far as I'm concerned, really isn't that great. But I think on your own, and again, Colleen, would be for your own benefit to operate more efficiently out of here. And you own quite a bit of land up on West Street in Reading, and there's a lot just north of it available. I don't know what the EPA regulations were, but it looks pretty good to me driving by, but I'm not a conservation expert by any means. And,
good.
But good. Again, it would put you closer to the central of your business. I can't imagine how much time it gets from here to go up Reading Square, to go up Lowell Street, to go to Wilmington. It must take them half to three quarters of an hour with the traffic in the morning. And that's certainly not efficient for you people. And that affects my light bill. So, thank you.
Good. Thanks. Any other comments from the...
Well, yeah. Bill, I'd just like to thank you for coming in. I completely agree with everything you said. And these ideas about making optimal use of real estate in town is great. And I'm not really sure what the best mode is to move forward. I know it's been discussed, as Colleen said. It's not just obviously a board, RMLD board, but, you know, selectmen and town meeting.
I think it's your move. As I recall, when we disposed of 25 Haven Street, it was the board of the commissioners at that time that said.
Sure.
Although the property, it has to go through town meeting. I don't think there's any big problem.
I don't think anybody here would have any problem with doing what's the best as far as optimizing use of town land and everybody's finances. I don't speak
again,
to everybody,
not,
but
not just for your benefit, yeah. Not for the town's benefit, for your operational benefit.
Yeah, I'm sure we'd be. There's no disagreement that we would all want.
Resident here from Wilmington, and I know West Street very well. I was born right off of West Street.
Okay, and on your second point, I think, you know, solar on town property, which is something else you just mentioned. Mm-hmm. Is also a great idea. It has to happen at different levels because we don't actually own the land. We don't control town land or town roofs. So
I can nag the selectmen if you'd like.
That'd be great.
I'm pretty good at nagging.
Sure.
Chairman, the only thing I want to mention is on the canopies. I did see when I was in Florida, I did see a large parking that had canopies, and it really wasn't that bad. It wasn't It wasn't an eyesore or anything like that. And so anybody who has, and just not the town, but any big parking lot.
Well, even the high school parking lot.
Yep.
You know, I mean, I know the town.
High school, but
I know the town. I know the town is looking for
even the ones
income,
on Walker,
and
you know,
got a
the big
from
parking
the finance
lot on Walker's Brook Drive.
Yeah.
I mean, that potentially would be something that they
right.
should consider.
And
to
I
go
think
beyond just town land. It
yeah,
should be.
I agree with you.
Many other, you know,
yeah.
and many of the
private and public
in
sites.
The district.
But what town bodies can control is town property, as you're pointing out.
Yeah.
And the other obvious one is flat roofs, which is the cheapest way to put it on a roof, if I'm not mistaken. Jane will correct me. But it's the least expensive because you don't have to drill into the roof. You don't have to, you can actually just sit the stuff down there. And there's a lot of flat roofs that are owned by both public and private entities.
Wow.
It's something that we were actively looking at, what the cost of that would be, either through developers or direct by RMLD. Am I speaking out of turn, Jane? Colleen? No.
Mm-hmm.
It's something we're actively looking at.
Yeah, okay.
But again, it has to be the people who own the buildings, mm-hmm. whether it be a private company or
yeah,
whether it
like
be a municipality.
Said, the town does own the parking lot.
Right,
all the way
and the town owns a bunch of roofs.
Washington Street all the way up to High and Vine, and that's probably, what, half, three quarters of a mile. So you've got a lot of territory that you can hang some flags on. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Bill. We'll take these under consideration.
Oh, just do it. I'm not taking it under consideration. Just do it.
Okay.
And you have my vote at town meeting if I'm still there.
All right. I think you will be.
I'm up for reelection next year.
You got to make the
good luck with that.
And by the way, the 24th of this month will start my 50th year.
That deserves some recognition. Thank you, Bill. Okay. Next, we have Dennis, is there an Assistance Advisory Board feedback that you'd like to share?
For us, it was, we were short three members, so we've added two, one from Reading, one from North Reading. I don't know if there's any word on anyone from Linfield yet, but so the meeting was pretty quick this time, kind of more like an introduction. As you know, it was difficult to talk about much else.
Yeah. Do we, can we summarize who the new members are?
Yeah, I Cohen has,
Neil
Mr.
Cohen.
Cohen, Neil Cohen.
And he's going to
he's
be
from Reading.
Reading.
Yeah.
Yep.
And Jason Small.
From North Reading.
Correct.
Yep, Jason Small.
And Jason works at Danvers Light, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And does that bring the team up to full?
No, we still need one more from Linfield.
One more from Linfield.
But at least now we can get a quorum.
Okay. Right. Okay.
And I think Neil Cohen was on your committee. Is that right? Was he in the Finance Committee or some? Been involved in something?
No, I
think.
I was there.
No, I think at one point he was.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah,
he's been involved in several things in Reading.
Yeah. Neil Cohen. Yeah.
I think he was at one time Finance Committee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. And Dave, did you have a? Were you at the last committee as well?
Yeah. I think. I think Dennis summed it up well.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Well, staffing is the key there. Okay. So. A couple of items from my perspective for the chair. One is really just discussing, and I think the next step is the scheduling of a board strategic meeting. So, Colleen, you had raised that recommendation a few meetings ago, and I know that in conversations with Tracy, you know, the hardest thing about these sorts of things is finding a date mm-hmm. and time. So, what do you think, Tracy? Did you have some possible suggestions, or do we want to just get people ready to respond to some dates by email? Or?
I had a tentative date of Tuesday, May 16th. But I also, with morning or evening work best for everyone?
Yeah, subject to John's input, maybe, you know, in thinking about it, I guess the first thought is, you know, is it, you know, offsites can be three-day weekends, which I don't think we're proposing, or they can be a full day or a half day or whatever. So
when you say offsite, what do you mean?
Well, I guess it's more. It doesn't have to. I would assume we could probably meet here. It doesn't have to be offsite.
Be
we could actually use one of the town meeting spaces if we felt we needed to. I guess that would be more, Colleen, from your perspective in terms of your ability to, you know, be able to. Be fully present and not have the day-to-day business circling you, but
at least the library.
Yeah, so we can, I guess we can noodle that one separately. But what, Colleen? You have a kind of some topics. We all have a number of topics. So is a half a day kind of what you're thinking?
I would think a couple hours would be good.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there any chance we could do it sooner than mid-May? Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think the reason that we had decided them was just because of all the budget meetings going on, but I can see if we can try to help that out.
Phil, I know your schedule's pretty
I cannot meet before April 18th.
That's, yeah, that's why we did not want to do it before tax time.
I get freed from jail.
Yeah. Well, let me just try a few general questions. Are people with some planning, are people available to do a morning meeting?
Sure. Late April I could do,
yeah.
Or May.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I guess the alternative would be a late afternoon, mm-hmm. evening.
Morning's fine.
Okay.
Yeah, morning's fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right.
I know John said that he likes the morning meetings.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So why don't we give Tracy some time to sort of think about maybe end of April, early May, something like that. Mm-hmm. You'll be recovered by then, Phil?
Hope so.
Hopefully. Yeah.
Hopefully.
We'll try to get some dates out to the board. Is there Any blackout dates generally? I mean, Mondays or Fridays or Wednesdays, just to...
I can't do it between April...
Mondays would be out for me.
12th. You may run into his town meeting.
20th.
I don't know what the schedule of town meeting is.
Yeah, I can't. I'm going to be out of town.
Does it, can town, is it a conflict if we have a morning meeting on the night of town meeting?
No, you just can't have a meeting during town meeting.
Yeah, so we should be free there.
Yeah, we're free.
And so no Mondays, Dave, right?
Yep. So what about that 23rd or 4th or something? Yeah. Or 6th? I can't do 25th, yeah.
So why don't we, now that we've sort of fixed the block of time, why don't we let Tracy know, if we could, tomorrow or Monday latest, what blackout times mm-hmm. are in that period, you know? Check your calendar.
I can send out a few dates, too. It might just be easier if I grab...
Yeah.
Okay. Work it out.
All right. Okay. Good. Anything else, Colleen? And I guess we can talk in between time about getting an agenda going, so we just kind of... lots to talk about, including the topics this evening that Bill raised, but try to keep it prioritized. But I think it'd be a good time. We haven't had a chance to do that as a board. And
right.
With everything we're dealing with, that would be very helpful.
I think Mayhew's discussion tonight will help set some couple of agenda items as well on there.
Nice. Good. Anything else from the board as far as input on? We'll let Tracy do her thing and get us,
yep.
get
yeah,
us going.
Sounds good.
Good. So the second item is strategy and plan to improve demand reduction at peak times. Dave, can you tee that up? I know that was something you had expressed an interest to have on our agenda. So.
Well, I didn't have anything prepared, but I mean...
Yeah, no, but just in terms of...
I mean, a couple of things we had talked about were, is there a way to throw a time-based rate into the mix more widely than we do now to... tend to bend the curve a little bit.
Yeah, that was some follow-up to
and then there
the previous meeting. Right?
There was an email traffic about that. I don't know if that's coming up tonight.
Yes.
So that's going to get covered tonight.
So do we want to, does that fit into your presentation?
No, we were going to go up and just strategize.
Talk about that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. That's okay.
Yeah. Sure. That's
Mr. Chairman, can I meet
yes, you? Please.
So I guess in Dave and some of the questions that were asked, maybe, Jane, we could, in the presentation, we're going to discuss the rates that we already have, the interruptible rates that have occurred in the past, of why those don't exist anymore. Do we have a discussion? Can you start off with that, then?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
All right, so why don't we, when we get to that, we'll cover those items that allow that you can position it.
And while they're queuing up, I guess the other general topic was something Colleen's talked about, and Hamid, who's not here, but just being able to do more investment in the grid to make it more intelligent so that we can have the ability to collect data and design things more intelligently and be able to do more demand reduction that way.
Yes.
So, I mean, it's nothing, it's just a long-term thing that
right.
we need to be doing.
When we go over the capital budget in another few weeks, one of the line items that continues to be on there is grid optimization. So we'll, even though that's a 15-year plan, we'll talk about the next things that are happening, including the AMI mesh overlay. And I think those will speak to the topics that you're talking about. We'll tell you
great.
What's up next in the queue for smartening up our grid.
Good.
Thank you.
Okay. Colleen, we'll circle back to you after this. Is that?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, Jane.
Well, some of the things that we were talking about and that we just wanted to bring to the board's attention is how cyclic some of these things can be, and depending on the industry in general. So way back when Seabrook was coming online and there were several delays to that, there was a capacity deficiency throughout the New England region. And as a utility, RMLD enacted some rates to try to combat that. So at the time, we had seasonal rates. We had a different rate in the summertime than we did in wintertime. So our demand components were different for those two periods. We also had in place non-firm and interruptible rates, which we had a handful of customers who would opt into the rate. And then during peak periods of time, they were required to shed load, or they would be financially penalized for not shedding that demand. So that was part of the interruptible rate. We've since, in the early 2000s, we were in a capacity long position. We had over 10,000 megawatts that was installed within New England. We've gotten away from seasonal rates. We have a flat rate structure now. We still do have the time of use rate, which we have not a lot of customers, but that is time-based rates where our demand charge is only occurring between the hours of noon and 7 p.m.
This is residential.
Both commercial and residential. So residentials don't have a demand component, so that their energy rate is different on peak versus off peak. On the commercial side, there's a demand component to how the rate is calculated, and that demand only looks at the periods from 12 p.m. to 7 p.m. And so if they were to peak demand during the off-peak period, it's advantageous to them because they're not charged for that. It's only during that peak
Those
period.
Are optional plans, right? All of
Correct.
What you just described. Okay.
Correct. You know, we have our PDR program was our peak demand reduction program. Because of some of the metering constraints, we can't open that up to all of our customers because they need to have smart meters in order for us to measure the demand reduction. So we have about 20 customers that are signed up for that. The first year that we had that in place, we shed about a megawatt worth of demand. Last year, it was significantly less. We shed about 250 kilowatts. And just yesterday, we had the lunch and learn with the systems in there. And we're trying, and it's very interesting to get some of the feedback from North Reading School System in terms of, you know, they understand what they have to do, but throughout their organization, if there's not a common theme, like the business manager doesn't know what the facility guys is doing and the benefits that the facility guys introduces to have to the overall billing, that's problematic. So we were kind of brainstorming about ways to get more people within the organization involved about the benefits and how the financial incentives are geared towards that program. A lot of our rebate programs are structured based on peak demand. So we do have some programs. They're just not mandatory. And I know I was sensing from Dave's comment that he's looking more for maybe a rate base that would be something other than people opting in.
Yeah, that's the gist of it. I mean, what percentage of residential customers do opt into time of use?
We have probably less than 300.
So 1%. And then what percentage of commercial customers opt into time of use?
Well, for the commercial customers, it's really set up for customers that have three shift levels or grocery stores benefit because they have refrigeration on all the time. So it's really geared towards how you operate your business. You know, a small mom-and-pop restaurant that's open for breakfast, lunch, it's very difficult for them for that rate to work for them. Because that's when they're servicing their clientele. So it really is specific to what businesses are able to do and what they're able not to do.
Right. So the high concept was just to nudge it up a little bit for everybody in the late afternoon when we have big peak costs of hundreds of thousands of dollars if we can knock off a megawatt. That's the high concept. And I guess I've always wondered why we can't raise it a nickel. Not literally a nickel per kilowatt, but why we can't do that across the board for, like, commercial customers. A little bit, but make it less for the rest of the time so they can benefit if they adjust their operations a little bit.
Jane, is there any, I don't know how much benchmarking data you have or is even available. So do we know what other communities are doing? Obviously, we're not the only one looking to shave the peak, so to speak. So is there something else that... And is that, I don't know, Mr. Steve, if you have a thought, is the carrot better than the stick, or is there some combination, or what? And how much is marketing? So, you know, a lot of it, I think, you know, Dave's given us a lot of insight to this over the last year or two, and so some of it, I wonder if, you know, is there enough marketing of the benefits? I know we're doing a lot, and it's hard to over-communicate on some of this stuff, so... I don't know if you have any thoughts on those questions.
Absolutely. So with my economist hat on, there's really two ways that you get customers to do what you want them to do. One is the passive approach of you send the correct price signal to the customer and let the customer decide. And the other is as with your peak reduction program, you actively enable and facilitate the customer doing something to modify their behavior. Right now, you're doing both of those things, and you're probably doing them more and better than any other municipal utility is. But there are plenty of areas where you can expand that. The key is that, as we all know, the cost of electricity varies all the time, and there's quite a few pieces to that. The price of the energy itself, it fluctuates during the day. Looking at the spot market price, that's the benchmark. So it goes up during the day and it goes down at night, but that's a pretty small variation. It's not more than 1 or 2 cents a kilowatt hour difference between the cost during the day and the cost at night. What we're talking about here are costs that are really demand related, that are basically transmission and forward capacity, and those prices are, if you look at it on a time basis, are zero in the case of capacity for 8,759 hours in the year, and then really, really big 1 hour of the year. And you don't necessarily know when that hour is going to be.
Except it'll always be between 3 and 7.
Except when it isn't, because sometimes, usually between 3 and 7. And similarly with...
When is the annual peak not between 3 and 7?
It hasn't been, but just as an example of that, transmission peaks in the wintertime always occur Monday through Friday.
In the wintertime, right.
Last year, we had a transmission peak on Sunday, Valentine's Day. Never occurred throughout the history of the utility. It's happening now.
Right.
And so Mayhew's correct. It is between 3 and 7 now, but that's not to say if new technologies come that doesn't shift.
Right.
But you're correct. If you just look historically.
Now, if you were to design, a perfect rate that exactly charged everybody for what they were using each hour, including those 12 hours each month, one each month, and then the one in the summer, you would end up with a rate that would. In comparison to what you charge presently, would enormously disadvantage some customers and enormously advantage others. Because at the end of the day, there's very little that most customers can actually do to change the amount of energy that they're using during those monthly peaks and annual peaks. There are some customers who can,
Everybody can turn up their thermostat in the summer.
But they need to know exactly when to do it.
Between 3 and 7 when their price is higher. I mean, that's all I'm saying.
Yes.
And I'm not talking about a precise load following thing. Only question I have is, our commercial rates are the same 24/7, 365, except for those few that take our optional time of use. And all I've said is, instead of just knocking everything up 1 cent 24 hours, what if you brought it up 2 cents from 3 to 7 and 0.75 cents for the rest of the 20 hours? So they're better off 20 hours and they're worse off for 4 hours, a little worse off. Well, and then if they do a tiny bit, they probably can come out ahead and we could come out. There's a sweet spot in there, in theory, right?
I mean, what you're describing is a classic time of use rate. It's right. An on-peak, off-peak rate.
But a mandatory one.
And that's also fairly straightforward. In the private utility world, customers who use more than say 100 kW of demand have been on mandatory time of use rates for years. That's just the way the regulated utility works. voluntary or optional time of use rates are bad economic policy, because all you get are a bunch of free riders.
Right.
That's
not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about implementing it across the board.
Right. And so, you know, that is
about, what
that,
you
that's
just
a
said
very,
is what we have.
It's,
is
a,
the
it's a very sensible approach.
Yeah.
It may not send a strong enough price signal because simply because a couple of cents difference between.
But do we have
the
any data
hours
to support anything what you're saying? I mean, is there data that would say if we did X, Y would happen?
Or we just I'm sure there's been research done that shows what the threshold is that actually causes behavior change. But
where is that research? I mean, isn't that what we're here to talk about? Like, what's the evidence and what's the data that shows what we, if there's anything we could be doing?
Can I interject?
Yeah.
Yes. I think you were just answering creature habits. And I don't think that's what you're asking. I think
I'm asking if there's any data to support the board just doing what it does every year, which is kind of rubber stamp the across-the-board increase.
Okay. So I think what I'm hearing is if the IOUs have a mandatory time of use rate, do we have data? Can you run that through the model to show what the price difference would be based on our model?
I could do that, but I actually have another approach that I think might accomplish even more than that.
Right.
And that is that presently, the price signal that really matters is the demand charge that you charge large customers, not the energy charge, because that's the thing that they can actually control and would have a big impact. And presently the demand charge that you charge large customers who pay a demand charge is much lower than your actual cost.
Okay.
And a good part of that is because those two price components, capacity and transmission, are being recovered through a flat cents per kilowatt hour charge, through the purchase capacity and transmission charge and the fuel charge. The purchase capacity and transmission charge probably should be a demand charge rather than a cents per kilowatt hour charge. And it would probably be in the vicinity of $12 a kilowatt, because that's a rate that I've worked up. Your transmission rates and your capacity rates are the same as every other municipal, and those are rates that I've developed recently for other municipal utility clients. If you were to do that, you would send a very strong price signal to control demand, and while it's not as closely targeted as you would like, it's not targeted to that specific peak hour.
Mm-hmm.
You can target it within a 4-hour range, for instance. I've seen this done where you have a demand charge that's based on 100% of your demand within that 4-hour period, or 80% of your highest demand outside of that period, so that they can have a much higher demand outside of the 4-hour critical peak period, and not worry so much about it, and not incur those higher charges. The downside of that is that as with anything that you do to change a rate across the board, there are going to be winners and losers initially. And many of the losers may not have the ability to control their business practices, their behaviors, in a way that that prevents them from being harmed by it.
Is there any examples where you have seen that implemented? And so another actually case studies that you could look at and say, we did it here, and it actually, you know, had a positive impact without, you know, disenfranchising customers?
I haven't, because I've yet to succeed in persuading a municipal utility client to go to that great an extent. There is one that was just voted last week, but it won't go into effect until July of this year. So
what was that?
It's the town of Mansfield put a $12.60 capacity and transmission demand on their two largest classes of customers.
In order to attack the peak?
Yes, exactly.
And they just voted that in?
Yeah.
OK. can we take a look at the, what that was and be able to kind of look at that at RMLD, whatever they did?
I can certainly send you a copy of the rate schedules. They were voted at a public meeting on Monday, so that's not, it's not a secret.
I mean.
Are you looking for just a copy of the rate or the analysis that they looked at before they voted on it?
I guess I'm looking to see if there's anything RMLD can do to attack at a high level. What we're trying to do is, you know, our peak costs have gone through the roof, and we're looking for creative ways to use our rates to do more than we're doing now to be able to attack the peak, because every megawatt is saves us $250,000, right? Or something like that.
Well, it's important to take a step back, and there's this sense, and you hear, and I hear it fairly often, that we need to control the peak because it's costing us a lot of money, and in a sense, it's costing the ratepayers a lot of money, and it doesn't make any sense to charge the ratepayers more to control something than what the value of controlling it is. In other words, if you're charging them $12 a kilowatt, then if they choose to control their demand, that's fine. If they choose not to, they're going to pay for it. So the key is that they're economically indifferent, and so are the other customers. You want to be sure that nobody is subsidizing anybody else because they either are or aren't controlling their usage during those critical periods.
Mr. Chairman, if I may ask, can we? I mean, we're this is all a discussion, mm-hmm. and at some level, it's abstract discussion.
Right.
Can we have numbers and options that we can look at and analyses that would say, okay, this might do this, but there could be this potential downside? Can we actually get data and numbers to look at? Because that's like our main job is to set rates, and I feel like this is important to understand and look at actual numbers. And as Tom said.
I just want to jump in for some clarification. So based on what you just said, are you really saying it's a zero-sum game, that, you know, there's winners and losers, but at the end there's no net savings? Are you not saying?
If you set prices correctly, if you send the right price signal to people, then whether or not they act on those price signals, they're indifferent, and so is everybody else. In other words, if that large customer down the street that's adding a megawatt to your peak, as long as they're paying the cost of that megawatt that they're causing and nobody else in the system is, then you're fine.
But of course, they're not doing
that. What you don't want is a situation where everybody else pays because some customers are causing a large peak.
But that is what happens right now.
It to a certain extent it is, and we can show, you know, one of the things that we can do is the analysis that you're talking about is you know, how do costs get shifted under the present rate, and how would a different rate design reduce, probably can't eliminate, but at least significantly reduce the amount of cost shifting that takes place.
Reduce the unfairness and maybe reduce the peak. That would be the goal, right?
Maybe reduce the peak if customers, you know, right. if they make the rational decision to whether or not to control their demand or not.
To Tom's point, is there data? Is there data we can look at? Are there options we can look at with scenarios unfolding with what would happen if we did some of these things?
I would say yes. We can certainly provide.
We don't have it tonight, I guess.
No, okay. We don't. Okay. No, I mean, what I'm talking about are RMLD specific analysis of different rate designs and what the impact of that might be.
And is that the logical next step? I mean, is there any other, I mean, we've talked about that as sort of being the strategy to get at it the most efficient and effective way.
I think it is. I think that you can also go down the road of making time of use rates much more widespread, applying them to more customers. I'd say one problem that you have is that there are going to be implementation costs to that, metering and billing costs, and I don't think that the analysis, and I'll do that analysis as well. I don't think that the analysis will show that that's as effective, that simply, you know, adding 2 cents to an on-peak energy charge is going to be as effective as putting a $12 demand charge in place.
Fine, then let's, the $12 demand charge sounds good to me.
Let me just check a couple of comments. So is there any other board input? Dennis, did you have any comments before? What I'd like to do is, after we have any more board comment, Colleen has asked, since, you know, I think we want to make sure we have you and your staff's thoughts on this. So that sounds like a reasonable next step, but is there other board comment before I ask Colleen to jump in?
I only have one question. What is the implementation cost? Like, to put time of use meters to all customers, how much would that cost us?
Take a guess.
Do we have a guess, like a ballpark?
Ballpark.
I'm not, you probably have a better idea than I do.
4 million.
But forget about residential, like all.
You'd have to replace all the meters.
Yeah.
Right.
But how about all, just, I mean, commercial or this, we wouldn't do it on all residential ones. We care about the big consumers for the rate. Like all commercial customers, you're talking about a lot less than that.
Yeah, you do run into diminishing returns when you start looking at residential.
Right. So how many meters are, to Dave's question, how many meters that are industrial?
We have 3,000 commercial customers. Okay. Of that, I'd have to get the data of how many are 100 kW or greater, yeah. Some type of parameter.
Yeah.
The new smart meters, we'll have to double check the parameters of how you can program them. It might be other two, because remember we stopped and we purchased different meters for the 500 club. But yeah, Mayhew's doing the cost of service this year. This is our third year, so it's time to do it. And you know, we've met with Mayhew. We want to all, I think we're all on the same page,
yeah,
that we'd like to be able to do that. But I think, yeah, what I'm hearing from Mayhew is, you know, we have to be careful of the winners and losers.
Right.
And
yeah,
you know, and
that's where the data will help.
Right.
Yeah.
At the same time, we're talking about economic growth and keeping our customers here. You know, so we're trying to balance a lot of different things at the same time. And so I just want to make sure that when Mayhew runs these figures, that we're able to balance all the pros and cons of making a change like that. And I'd be very interested to see the analysis from Mansfield about what their demographics are, what percentage makes up their residential and commercial, and you know, what the winners and losers are going to be. Because like you said, just because there's a different rate doesn't necessarily mean that that company has an automated demand management,
right,
system. They might be still manually running around trying to shut things off during the peak, which is much different than maybe a high-tech company that they hit a switch and all of the pumps come on, you know, staggered in different ways that they can control their demand. And not everyone in commercial has that ability without a lot of cost, capital cost on their end to be able to do that.
Yeah, and that's one of the areas where I think municipal utilities have are in a much more advantageous position compared to private utilities, because you tend to have a much closer connection with your customers, and rather than just throw this this rate at them, you can also work with them to give them some tools to actually manage the change. So that's a big part of it, and obviously you're not going to want to jump into a change like this without being prepared to deal with the consequences.
And part of the analysis would include sort of the assessment of which segments of the customer base would be a potential risk. So, I mean, I think what Colleen's saying is we don't want to do this and then find out, you know, we.
Yeah, I'll certainly, you know, go through, give you folks a listing of all the customers above a certain size and how each individual customer would be impacted by the change.
I think we did something similar, didn't we, a year or two ago with respect to rates, where we sort of looked at, when we changed the rates, actually, we did, mm-hmm, that kind of exercise, right, across the segments, you know.
Right, we were looking at low-income rates and,
yeah,
how that gets shifted.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what about, you know, Dave brought it up, but I mean, I'm guessing that for some of our customer base, the savings of electricity from shutting down pumps and other equipment could be offset by
the problem of, you know, restarting and having, you know, downtime because the thing doesn't, you know, when the pump is running, the pump is running, but when you shut it down, you know, then, you know, constant shutting down daily and upstart, is that an issue of concern?
Well, it can be, but that's, you know, that's an area where, well, one, you probably want to take kind of a hands-off approach, because you know, there's potential issues of liability anytime you're getting involved on the customer side of the meter.
Yeah, I'm just asking from a practical, you know, would a customer's behavior be, you know, if they can save X dollars in demand charges, will they look at it? Because if they're doing a batch process or something, it costs a hell of a lot more. It may cost them hundreds of thousands of dollars.
This is where you like to assume that you have a rational consumer and that they understand what their costs are of not consuming. Years ago, when I worked at the Taunton Municipal Light Plant, the largest customer there was a company that made crystal glass. And they had an electric arc furnace that they used to melt the glass. And we tried to get them interested in an interruptible rate because they had about a 2-megawatt load on that furnace. And they said that if we turned that thing off within 5 minutes, we would have about $500,000 worth of useless solid glass there. Yeah. So, yeah, there's you hope that they're capable of making those decisions themselves.
Yep.
That, okay, if we interrupt, we're going to lose so much production, so it's not worth it to us. And hopefully they'll be clever enough to figure out some way around that.
Yeah. Good. I think it's good discussion. So,
I think it was like, I mean, you got to look at different buildings and different manufacturing, but you look at a school. Our new high school gets a lot of use now in the summer.
Yeah.
Everybody wants that program in there because it's HVAC.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So when you're thinking about, oh, we're just going to shut it off between 5 and 7, we have a lot of special needs programs in there. There are children that are susceptible to temperature changes.
Yeah.
So that's great. I can shut off 13 out of the 14 air handlers, but I still have to run 2 centrifugal chillers. So to shut off the whole system or try to subcool it to a point and hope this person may not be affected. So it's not always as easy as just, right, you know, the want to do it. It's, you know, how the building's used, what you're using for manufacturing like you're talking about. So there's a lot of different things that come into play when you're talking about, you know, shutting things down for a 4-hour, 5-hour period. Right. That a lot of us don't have control over.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, there's a lot of very customer specific issues.
Yeah, exactly. And you have to trust the customer knows their business.
Right.
And
yes, please.
So, in our tangent plan program that we're running, we didn't have a lot of people. Can you tell us how that went for? You know, sharing the incentive of curtailing.
Right. So the first year we had 12 to 14 people that participated. They were very enthusiastic. We shed a megawatt worth of reduction. We shared 50% of that savings with the customer. It was very successful. And then the second year, because we had a very hot summer, we called peak periods, I want to say 6 to 8 periods of time. And sometimes what happens is by, you know, it didn't happen till August 12th at 3 p.m. So after numerous occasions, for whatever personal reasons, and we're talking with those customers to try to determine where there was the problem. But we went from a megawatt of success in year one, and in year two, it dropped to 250 kW as a voluntary program. Even though the price advantage increased significantly because starting June 1st, our capacity costs are going up, you know, to around $15 a kW, which Colleen has been addressing over the last 2 to 3 years. So we're going from 7 to 15, and had they been able to save that, it would have been considerable savings to them. And again, there's people in the room that we had the lunch and learn that are very enthusiastic and eager to do this. They have a myriad of things that they're responsible for. And so when they get that email, depending on the day and what's required from them from upper management, they may or may not be able to participate. So again, it's lessons learned. Sometimes it's just not feasible for them to partake because it's not a high priority.
I wonder, Jane, I've often thought when we first had talked about this, is it maybe we don't characterize it or market it. So the problem is, we think it's going to be a day, and then it isn't. So it's sort of like crying wolf, right? So eventually they say, well, yeah.
It's the nature of the peak period, though.
Yeah, no, but I mean, if you think about it in a different way, as a process, you know, so, you know, it's certainly not going to be 100 days where they're going to have to do that.
Correct.
So if we sort of educated the customer around, it's probably not going to be a single, you know, we're never going to get it right on one day, but there'll be four or five times during the summer period that we might ask you to be vigilant. So now, because I think what happens is individuals say, well, it's not today, okay, so it's got to be, you know, it only happens once, but you need to do it five times to get that once. Do you know what I mean?
I agree with you.
I do think there's a mindset, and then because the reason they're busy is because they're saying, not only they're busy every day in a plant, right? No one's sitting around, you know, reading
Correct.
The paper or on the internet. What it really is they just say, I'm busy and I don't have time to do what may well not be peak day, right? Whereas if it's this is a process, you got to do it five times to get, you know,
to get a win.
Right.
So, if you look at manufacturing, you know, every day you're trying to generate as much revenue as you can. So that trucks, you're trucking whatever time of day that is, you're trying to meet all your demand, get as much revenue as you can for the day.
Yeah.
So saying between these hours, I can back off from production, yeah. or I can change that. I've got to look at that. I have till 8 o'clock tonight to get to that, or 10 o'clock, whatever that trucker will come
yeah.
in at, to get it out there and get that daily revenue.
Right.
So when you're talking manufacturing, it's not as simple as,
nope.
you know, mm-hmm. as good as it sounds. It just, you know, you got to weigh it out. I need to be able to produce a certain amount yeah. of revenue every day, and, you know, I can't, as much as I want to turn equipment off, how would I?
Mr. Chair, may I ask a quick request?
Yep.
Those are good points, Dennis, by the way. So nobody's saying anybody has to shut down. All I've been saying is, like, get to pay a tiny bit more maybe, and that just sends a signal that might tend to, where possible, depress demand at the times we need it most, and then they benefit the rest of the day. Mm-hmm. The two requests I would have is, given that peak costs have doubled or whatever they have in the last couple of years, could we have a report on how does that spill out in terms of who is subsidizing whom right now? So those peaks now, who are the peak users that are in effect being subsidized by the rest of the ratepayers? That would be request number one, a report on that. And request number two is, as general, what are the ideas for how we could change rate structures in such a way to address that disparity? An open-ended question, other than the usual way of just increasing everything across the board like we always do. That's it.
Well, and I think the Mansfield experience.
And
right?
Yep, and to know
to
what
the
they did.
It answers one of both of those.
That's what I would be interested in. Those are the two things I would be interested in knowing.
Okay. Everyone okay with that? Colleen?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good.
Thank you.
Jane, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good information.
Thank you, Jane.
Good discussion.
Thank you, Mayor.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. Colleen, did you want to get us back on schedule?
Sure. I have a couple of updates.
Okay.
And, I'm actually going to be speaking from Mead as well for the engineering and operations report. So thank you all for authorizing me to go down to the APPA legislative rally. It was an enlightening trip. I've never gone before. Had an opportunity to meet a number of our congressmen and senators. It's very interesting in Washington and the underground system of getting places throughout the legislative buildings. There was three main topics that we discussed. One was municipal bonds and keeping them from becoming taxed.
Thank you, Mr. Seavey.
Thank you, ma'am. And keeping them from becoming taxed and showing, you know, for our capital projects and other municipals
mm-hmm.
Wanting to get bonding, that would really hurt us. So that was one of the topics. We had one that had to do with forward capacity. Braintree was there and was talking about how submitting their capacity of a new 15 megawatt plant wasn't even going to make the cut, so it didn't make any sense for them to actually build, to build anything. And so they were hoping that there would be some kind of control over the ISO or any of the regulatory bodies that could prevent the amount of cost that's coming forward for all of the municipals in public power from that respect. We did talk a little bit about the state of Massachusetts and some of the legislation that might be coming through here on going to 100% renewable into the future and being able to take credit for some of the non-carbon emitting plants that we already have, because that could really, really be significant going in the future. And the reason why that was brought up is because the DEP works with FERC and NERC, and it all works together, and we wanted to make sure that they understood what was happening, because the ISO that basically runs the system in this area, they're down in Washington weekly giving presentations, and we're not down there. So a lot of rules are made and changes are made without anyone thinking about the municipals and the impact on our ratepayers. And as you know, we're talking about the capacity being really significant going forward. We just want them to understand that these changes, that they have to stop and think about us, that we are vertically integrated, we have long-term power supply contracts, and we're not like them. And so we need to have possibly some different rules for us, or at least have a say. Do you want to add anything?
No, that was very well said.
Okay, so those were kind of the topics. I won't get into details and stuff, but generally either the congressman or their staff person would listen to us and they would take notes, and we're going to follow them up with letters just expressing our concerns. And I think letters probably going forward, I just sent out a bunch and that I shared with you, and I think letters going forward even more as we go through this transition will be really helpful. Again, I just think we're just the small guy compared to the bigger fish, and you know, things get changed because they're not thinking about us. Yeah. And so I think from that perspective, it was a successful trip. And I got to meet Congressman Kennedy, so that was really
good.
Nice. Well, there's a lot of, when you go there, there's a constant inflow of, you know, you're one group of stakeholders with hundreds of thousands of other people lobbying for stuff, right? I mean, it's amazing how things happen just because, you know, as soon as you leave, there's 10 more groups right behind you, right, doing the same kind of...
Oh, yeah, the national surgeons, neurosurgeons were behind us, and then veterans, so it's definitely, a revolving door as far as people going in and expressing their concerns,
But the reason why it's good to be visible in those forums, because if you're not, the chances of getting any airtime is very, very small.
Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe, we're going to follow up with a letter. Jane will probably help me write it on being able to self-serve our capacity and take credit for the plants that we mm-hmm. already have. And, she'll help me craft something and we'll send it out, and I'll make sure I send you a copy. The art contest calendars, the student art contest, which I thought was successful. I hope you all felt the same way.
Very, very well done.
Yep.
The calendars have been designed and will be ordered and distributed soon. So
okay, good.
Nice.
Good.
Yeah, it's always welcome.
Mm-hmm. Joyce is our new community relations. We'll have to invite her to one of the meetings.
She came.
Okay. And so she's running an elder services walking club at the RMLD on Friday, March 31st to promote residential rebate programs, shred the peak, and answer billing questions. As well, the RMLD is appearing at the Town of Reading Earth Day event at Parker Middle School on April 22nd. It will have an LED light display and giveaways for the children.
Good.
Okay. Finishing up my presentations to our presentations, Jane has been joining me to the Reading Selectmen on Tuesday, March 7th. So we have one more left at the North Reading, which will be on April 18th. And then we'll start it again for the towards the end of the year.
Yep.
We did let everyone know so that they could segue into their budget that it was about a 3 to 4 or 5% increase that we're looking at. But that is always very preliminary and tentative. The auction on capacity closed. We're not quite sure exactly what that's going to mean. If there's an impact to what we've told them, I'll be sending out emails in addition to maybe running the cost of service. So we have a lot of numbers coming in at the same time and how this capacity auction is going to play into what we expected. I think we expected it to be a little bit lower and it came in a little higher.
Correct.
So whatever impact that is, I'll be sure to get that out. And you're thinking maybe within a few weeks?
Yeah, well, the budgets have to get to the CAB by March 31st.
Yeah, so. But I mean, Mayhew's going to do
that. Oh, yeah. But the second week, April 12th?
Within the 12th, right?
Yeah, the 12th. Okay.
Colleen, is there what's the target date for the increase?
The increase goes into effect July 1st.
Yeah, okay.
The part of the selectmen, you know, meeting with the town managers and then with the selectmen is to discuss any rate increases so it can segue into their town budgets. And we try to give them an idea. But again, you know, for the last 3 years, we've been telling them that outside of our control, the capacity and transmission increases are coming. And the auction just closed, so we have to analyze those numbers.
You know, just a thought for his next staff meeting. I wonder, I mean, relative to, you know, we constantly look at other providers of, you know, energy, and I think that most people, I think, in the towns we serve recognize that RMLD is, which doesn't reduce our desire to keep, you're making it better, but it's certainly a very competitive rate that we offer our customers. But I wonder, you know, in these times, any kind of increase can be, you know, without some data. I wonder if there's a, in marketing it, so to speak, with the customers, if there's some information, comparatives, you know, without necessarily getting into detail, but just, you know, which kind of substantiates that, because we all understand, you know, what that really represents in terms of the big picture and other competitors and so forth. So just something to think about.
On that note, what I'd like to do is we're going to be asking E&E if we can probably take part in their rate comparison, you know, because that's something you have to pay for.
It's
proprietary information that people like MWEP put together and different companies that you can get to put that together.
Yep.
I just ask that we wait until after this capacity auction and how it's affecting everyone, and they've had a chance to do their rate, their, you know, how it's affecting their rate, so that when we get some numbers put together, that it's apples to apples.
Yeah.
Because if all of a sudden we increase our rates and the other members, municipals haven't done it, it's going to look like we're really high and they're really low. So
it just means they haven't reported it yet.
They may not, right. So probably would be a good idea if we took a snapshot of what everyone's going to be putting out for July 1st.
Right.
Assuming that everybody's on that fiscal year. But Jane can look into that. She can talk to MWEC or E&E and we can get those numbers.
Yeah, because I think we have a good story to tell.
Yeah.
And it's.
I'm just saying, right now it's going to be transitional for a few months. So I think we're definitely going to have an impact. So, but we'll share that with you.
Yeah, and maybe it's nothing to do with providing that particular detail, but I think there's, you know, a story to be told, a short story about just how, you know, cost effective the rates are here in Reading.
Didn't we do something last year? I feel like I remember the last time there was a rate increase that we did. Yeah. We did do something last time. Yeah.
Yeah, so really it's really just I think following that. That's a good point, Dave. Yeah.
Right. We've been adjusting it. We've been looking at it every month, every quarter. And then every year we look at it, because before that, if you recall, that pitchfork time when I first came, it hadn't been really adjusted in a long time.
Right.
And so I think we've gotten all of the towns and the selectmen used to the fact that, you know, we're doing our due diligence, looking at it constantly, and then, you know, we have the science and the data to back it up, and it is what it is.
Right.
You know, it's 80% is power supply, it's a pass-through. And, you know, Wendy can attest that, you know, most of the rest is fixed costs, or semi-fixed costs that we've gone over, and we'll do that again to go through those numbers. So The last thing, and I'm hoping Jane will have Joyce put it on the website, and we may even tweet this out, because this might be important, but the RMLD phone number is changing from 781-942-6598, changing to that, sorry. It used to be 781-944-1340. So we have a new phone system, so it's changing to that new number, and I wish I had a little card to show you, but I don't.
It's on the website already.
It's been changed.
All right. Why does this change?
We've got a new phone system, correct?
It's just been a number that's been jumping, it's been bypassing to the 459-598 number. And then there's been problems within the last month where people are getting a quick busy signal by dialing and not being able to get into calls coming into the office. So we've had Verizon come out here, we've had them troubleshoot, and we're just trying to get people to use the 598 number.
Right. What is the new number?
942-6598.
Can I ask a question about that?
Yes.
So there's been a number that we've had for however many decades, and it's now no longer going to work?
It's been problematic.
Can't the phone company have it jump forward to this new number? I mean, it seems like a source of a big confusion for...
We've been publicizing both numbers. It's just a matter of getting it off the letterhead.
But the old number won't work. What will happen now when people call that number?
They get a fast, busy signal.
So can't the phone company do more than that? I mean, it's like...
This is the phone.
We put in a new phone system. We're having problems with them. It's just, we've kind of exhausted.
It seems outrageous to me. I mean...
Yeah, you would think normally you'd get new number is da-da-da-da-da, or if at least, or connect you to the new number. Is there anything we should or are we doing maybe with respect to, the electronic... billing? I mean, we have a normal statement that comes out for paperless billing, right? The notification, I wonder if we should include that as just maybe an additional.
I think it's outrageous if Verizon can't save RMLD's number that RMLD has had for 30 years and can't make it work anymore. I think that's completely outrageous and that.
I know, don't they switch numbers all the time? What if we just cancel that number and gut it back? Wouldn't it just clear it and reset
Whose number is that right now?
It's weird. It's a weird problem.
There's really a dilemma with the vendors right now. This is the problem. We're trying to get around this problem, and we're being told it's kind of a deadline. That's what we're being told.
Not a deadline.
I'll write an op-ed in the Boston Globe ripping them because it's ridiculous. How about that?
Mm-hmm.
Would that be helpful to the department?
It's a big problem.
Okay, I'll call them and I'll raise it with them. If that's okay, Mr. Chairman. I don't see how we have a number for 30 years and the phone company changes a public utility's phone number and can't make the phone number work. That's not acceptable. In my humble opinion.
Right.
So I'm happy to take it up publicly and loudly with them.
Yeah, why don't we...
If that's okay, Mr. Chairman.
I know you'll do it professionally. I guess I just asked you whether
ever be indiscreet or say anything untoward or indiscreet.
It just seems crazy that for all these years, I mean, yeah. I have the magnet on my refrigerator.
I want your magnet to be relevant.
I know I've got
to
take that off.
I want everybody's magnet to remain relevant.
I've got to take that down.
Why don't I have Mark Ivani, our IT
Yeah, sure. That's what I was going to say before.
I'll tell them, and I'll call Verizon, and I'll tell them I'm writing some stories about it, because once anybody up the ladder hears about this, they'll fix it. And they don't want to be embarrassed publicly, and that's what's going to happen.
Yeah, no, that's where I was going. So let's give Dave up to date on what has been done, a little background, so we don't waste time.
Sorry.
But I would also, obviously it's not... It's not shoot the messengers here, because I know the staff is that we've all had our own experiences with the phone company going back many years. But I do think as a consumer as well as being on the board, I think that it is problematic when you change something significant. I mean, I I had actually had to call for a different reason today, and I didn't have the number handy, and I went on the website, and I said, that doesn't seem like the same number, but, you know, it works, it was fine, but anything we can do to, in the meantime, to over-publicize, you know, or at least think about it, maybe in the outcome of data.
The old number should still work, is the bottom line, and either number should work and get you to where you need to go, in my opinion, as I'm sure you've been several, telling them for...
Comcast hooked it up and just had a call.
Yeah, I mean...
Probably oversimplification.
Yeah, all right, well, we got our best advice.
It might already be solved, since we're on Reading Cable TV, there might be somebody that works at that company watching us right now and fixing it, after they watch Dave.
We're not live tonight, are we?
Yeah.
No, we're not live today.
Yeah.
When we talk about the Verizon transfers and pull butt removals, maybe you can talk to them about that.
Sure. At some point, you have to start making noise.
Yeah.
That's maybe the job of board members, at least. So Phil, will you do that? I'm just joking.
No, you've already volunteered.
Yeah. Okay, good, we got some action there. Colleen, what else would you like to share, anything?
I'm good, thank you.
Oh, yeah, I was going to say, Jane, you have an encore performance, right?
Correct.
Yes, good. Didn't want you to...
I just have 5 slides for January's purchase power.
Yeah, Jane, could I, I know that John wasn't able to be here, and I know there's a couple of topics he, so in the interest of time, I don't, and if they're detailed, but maybe you could just do a quick...
Sure.
...summary, because the board's benefit.
Yep. So I have 5 slides to go over regarding January's purchase power. The first slide is a pie chart, which shows you the allocation of our power supply costs for the month of January 2017. And as reflected in this chart, fuel is represented by 54%, capacity is around 27%, and transmission is a little less than 19%. That, on an annual basis, is pretty reflective. It's just a slight... usually capacity is around 30%, so it's slightly decreased for the month of January, but transmission is in line with the overall costs on an annual basis as well. If we go to the next slide, this looks at capacity, transmission, and energy, and it looks at January costs going back for 2015, 2016, and 2017. As you can see, because of the price of natural gas and as a result of the department's laddering and layering approach, our energy costs have been going down over the last 3 years. Transmission has been going up, and that's a story that we've been talked about, as well as capacity has been fairly level, and that's kind of twofold. The capacity market has been increasing. However, some of our power supply contracts, the debt service on those contracts have been near paid off, so that has a negative effect on the total increase in capacity. One of the emails that I received from John was about the transmission costs. That's reflected in this next slide. In 2015, the RMLD paid a little over $721,000 in transmission. In 16, that went up to $873,000, and this past year we paid over $1 million in transmission charges. Mm. Transmission, for the most part, is socialized throughout New England. It's the infrastructure that the transmission owners, or the New England transmission owners, earn on that plant. We've been litigating that at FERC since 2011. Those transmission owners receive a return on an equity payment of around 11.5%, or 11.14, I think it is. And through our litigations with FERC, we've decreased that to 10.57, and it's still being appealed because we think those are unjust and unreasonable, and the only action that we can do is take legal action on that part. It's twofold on the transmission. We're based on the rate for that RNS, which represents about 90% of our transmission costs, and that monthly peak. So depending on what that peak value does and that rate, it's a combination of those increases why they are occurring. The next chart kind of looks at our capacity requirement versus our embedded cost of capacity. So the bar graph here looks at 2015, 16, and 17, and it looks at our kilowatt requirement for capacity, and that's based on that summer peak that we hit. So in 2015, that value was a little over 209 megawatts. In 2016, that went up to 224, and in 2017, that was 232. So that requirement is going up slightly, and it's based on New England's overall peak. We have to get our capacity requirement plus a reserve margin. Right now, that reserve margin is about 49%. And then we're required to cover that capacity for a whole year period. The cost of that capacity has been pretty flat in 2015 and 16, a little under $7.40. And again, the decrease in 2017 was a result of the market clearing price increasing, but an elimination of our working capital on our MWEC Stony Brook projects and our Millstone and Seabrook debt service being reduced and subject to being paid off in 2018. So that was the combination of those two things. The next and the last slide looks at embedded fuel and capacity costs. The capacity costs, as we showed you, have dropped in 2017, and our fuel costs have gone from a little under 5.5 cents to 5 cents, and that's a complete pass-through to our customers. John's second question on the email, because he wasn't able to be here, was based on the fact, and I think we brought this up a little earlier, the fact that RMLD's rates are competitive and it is significantly lower than the investor-owned utilities, and do we publicize that with our commercial customers? So with Joyce coming on as our new communication managers, we're looking at, historically, we used to have a separate newsletter that was geared towards commercial customers, as opposed to putting everything into a regular newsletter that we send to all our customers, so that we can focus either programs or rebates or shred the peak directly to those individuals, whether it's the billing office, the facilities office, on a more broader basis. So we're looking at doing something like that to help. We do talk about that when our integrated resource engineers go out. They meet with our large 500 club customers. There's about 50 of those customers. Each I have three engineers in my group that go out annually or biannually to visit with those customers. So some of those customers do have service territories in the IOU, so they're very much well aware of it. And for those that aren't, we do make it a point to bring that to their attention.
What is Joyce's last name? I'm sorry.
Mulcavy.
Okay, and what's her title? Communications?
A communications manager.
Oh, okay, and when is she started already?
She did. She started at the end of February, so she's been here just about a month.
Okay, it might be after she gets her bearings, it might be good to have her, you know, at one of the meetings.
Sure.
Just to introduce herself, and
sure,
she can talk a little bit about some of the,
because
a lot of the things we've talked about kind of fall in the space, right? There's things that, but obviously she just needs to find her
she's
way
doing
around.
A really good job. Yeah, she's hit the ground running, so I'd be happy to bring her.
Yeah. Good.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jane. Okay, Wendy, I know you've been anxious to share with us the financials, and we're anxious to hear.
I'm anxious because these are the first automated financials since I have taken this position.
Yay,
so,
well,
so I think this is finally coming around to benefit us. It still, in my opinion, needs a little tweaking, but for the most part, I'm extremely happy.
Good.
So I just wanted to look at accounts receivable. Unfortunately, Mr. Stempak's not here, but he's the one who mentioned possibly looking at some trends. So I chose accounts receivable this time around. And we're just looking at 3 years of accounts receivable and how it kind of goes through the dips and the peaks as far as moratorium and the end of moratorium and collecting with our credit and collections side of things. And if you look at the chart over there, it kind of follows the same flow for the most part throughout the first 7 months. In 2016, we were reviewing our processes and procedures, and that's where you see a little bit of a inconsistency there, and then we come again strong back at the beginning of FY17. So I don't know if that's interesting to you, but it's interesting to me, so I thought I'd share it with
yeah,
you.
Yeah, I guess
it's not on this slides.
It's, I mean, it's not on your computer.
No, we have it.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I put it on there.
We have it.
Thank you.
I hope it is, otherwise it's something wacky.
These two, this chart looks a lot like that one, so I think it is here.
I apologize.
So Wendy, what's the key, I mean, there's obviously a lot of different things going on here relative to year two, but what's the key takeaway, would you say, for the board?
I would say the key takeaway is that, for the most part, we have about anywhere, on a really good month, we have anywhere between 85-90% current receivables, which is, it's really a positive, positive thing for us, so.
I guess there's also, I mean, compared to some other businesses, the leverage is, you can turn things on and off, right?
Right, yep.
So, but still, yeah, that's good.
Yeah, so, I thought that was interesting to look at. Okay, and then if you turn to the second page of your packet, you have your, so that's the handout that I gave you. So I'm hoping this is the last actual handout, and everything will be now.
Board loves handouts.
Okay, well, I can still give them to you, but. So this is, we're looking at our capital funds. This is always nice to look at where our funds came from and where they're going. So year-to-date for January 31st, total use of capital funds is $3.6 million, and our source is 8.4, which leaves us with a total of $4.8 million. And we're right on target with our capital budget as we had, as we started the year. So I just wanted to point that out.
Good.
And then if you turn to the third page, this is, so this is what, this is a high level, which what I call a high level P&L, profit and loss statement. And then the fourth and fifth page gets into a little more detail on the profit and loss, including our revenue as a whole. And the fifth page shows our budget, so just so you know what you're looking at. When looking at the third page, for the month of January, our net income, or our positive change in net assets, was about $630,000, thereby increasing the year-to-date net income to about $3.8 million. And then we look at base revenues. Base revenues have exceeded FY16 by about $1.5 million, or 11%. Whereas year-to-date operating expenses exceeded FY16 by $1.3 million, or 12%. Actual base revenues were approximately $15.6 million, and actual operating costs were about $12.2 million. Year-to-date purchase power, so there's a little, I'm sorry that the next slide, there's a little error.
Just a question, Wendy.
Yep, go ahead.
So am I reading this right? So our operating revenues are up about 9% over last year, is that right?
Operating revenues, yes. But the slide that I was showing you was just base revenue, because that's where we make our money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to point out that the base is compared to the operating expenses. Because if you get PPCT, or purchase power, capacity, and transmission involved, there's a pass-through there. So it kind of, you know, tends to lead you astray of what the real numbers
okay,
are.
Okay, so what page you on?
I was still on page 3.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
She's separating out some of the numbers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And how does that compare to budget from a percentage point of view?
Oh, I wasn't sure. Okay. Hold on. Let me look over here. As far as the budget year to date.
Are you saying we're up about 11%?
No, from last year. I'm just going year to year.
Yeah.
I'm trying to show because of the increase in rates and whatnot.
Right, right.
So I'm just showing you that we're up 11%, but we're also up 12% in expenses.
Right, right.
I was just kind of showing
that,
you.
Yeah, but what did we budget in terms of an increase?
Okay, so I have it here, but I didn't prepare for it. So if you want, the
I was
fifth
just curious.
Page, the fifth page, the last page shows you the budget.
Yeah.
So the budget, we're at, we have 38% left in the budget, so we're about 2% down from where we should be, because we should be at 41.6% for 7 months of the year for revenue.
Okay.
Base revenue.
Is that evenly spread?
When you say evenly spread.
Each month, I mean, do we, you know, sometimes.
This is for the total year to date.
Yeah, but is each month considered, I mean, do you budget the same, do you divide by 12 when you get the
total?
No,
so what we discussed as a team is because some projects, first of all, forecasting revenue sometimes is very difficult month to month.
Yeah.
And because some operating projects, whether it be maintenance or what, we don't necessarily know which month they're going to be in.
Right.
So we've decided now to take the budget as a whole and kind of do by month. So right now we're at the seventh month, so 7/12 of the budget.
Yeah, so you do kind of do a monthly.
So we're not going to do a year-to-date actual to a year-to-date budget because it may not be accurate. And it you know, it doesn't really give you the right picture.
Yeah.
So we're trying to do.
Does it even out more if you did a quarter, not to change how you're doing it, but
yeah.
With a quarterly view, does it normalize when you look at things in quarters?
Well, I guess it depends on when the projects are scheduled. Sometimes, yeah. Depending on the weather, maybe Colleen can attest to this, yeah. You think you're going to get a project done, and it doesn't happen. And then, so then it doesn't get done to the other half
yeah.
of the year. So then you end up being over budget for half of the year, but that's really not true.
Yeah.
Because we just haven't yeah. gotten to it
yet. The reason I was really driving at it, it seemed to me that we're ahead of what I think we had planned to be in terms of revenue. Is that true?
No, we're actually 2% down. But overall, we're pretty on target with our budget because 41.6% is the target number. And overall, that's where we are at.
Okay.
So, I mean, we're looking pretty much on target for, yeah. You know, there's a little timing
yeah.
in some things,
yeah.
okay? But for the most part, we're pretty much right on.
Okay, thank you.
Okay?
Yep.
So I'll continue?
Please.
Okay. So the next slide, there is a slight error, and this goes back to just getting all of our staff up to speed. So year-to-date purchase power capacity and transmission revenue exceeded our PPCT expenses. Well, so this is what the chart show. No, revenue exceeded our PPCT expenses, $839,000. I'm sorry. And fuel revenue was actually below fuel expense, but the chart shows opposite. I apologize. The NIPA credit was not taken into effect there. So actually, the fuel revenue was below the fuel expense by about $463,000. So the net effect of that, which is what I talked about the pass-through, is only about $400,000. So it shows that Jane's group is pretty on target with trying to balance that out. So looking, and then when you look at the operating and maintenance expenses, okay, so I did a comparison from year to year, and then I compared it to the budget as well. So combined, we're under budget by about $250,000 or 2%. And the actual operating and maintenance expenses were $12.2 million, while budgeted expenses were $12.5 million. So as I mentioned, overall, we're on target with about 41.6% left of the budget. Make sense?
Yep.
Okay. Yep.
Good. Okay, so I just want to give you a little heads up that, in case you didn't remember, the Department of Public Utilities report is due on March 31st, and because the meeting is this week and not next week, it's not fully prepared, but it will be, and I'm going to have Gene Fody or Tracy coordinate you all to come in and get your signatures for the DPU report so we can submit it by March 31st.
Okay.
So I'm thinking like middle of next week.
Okay. Okay.
And we'll have them coordinate with best, you know, suits your schedule.
Okay. Good.
Okay.
Any other questions? Wendy? Good. Oh, good. Congratulations okay. on your new
Thank
system.
You. Well, if you have any suggestions or if you yeah. think you'd like to see something else, I
yeah.
mean, I'm
no,
happy
good.
To listen to,
yep.
You know, whatever you'd like to see.
Good.
Thank
All
you.
Right,
thank you.
Okay. So we have next is Ameed, and since he is away, Colleen, are you ready, willing,
yeah,
and able?
I'm going to go through some of it. I'm not going to go through every project.
No.
Okay.
Please.
Thank you.
So Ameed goes through these each month, so I'm not going to go through each one of them. Basically, his slides tell you what the percent complete is, and I've looked through each of the slides and everything, and based on all of the projects, expense and capital projects, he's on target. We're making the progress that we thought we were making. There isn't anything listed here that's on hold or in delay or anything like that. The LED streetlight conversion, 61.5%. That was something that the towns were interested in, conveyed to them how we're doing on that. So there's nothing here on the first slide that's of any significance, other than he's doing a great job moving everything ahead. On the routine constructions, I'm going to talk a little bit about the poles in the engines database. That's at the end of the slide. We can go over those. I have a little bit of a concern with them. Other than that, everything is moving on. We had a couple of storms that you all know about, but we had minimal damage and minimal outages, which was really great. Some of the towns didn't do as well as us, so we're grateful for that. On the next slide, on routine maintenance, you know, Hamid's gone over his 9 maintenance programs, and we're moving ahead. This is a lot of work that everyone is getting done, and it's great to see that we're starting to come up to a, we're finishing up failure analysis is basically, so when you don't do maintenance for a long time, you go in, you do these pilots, and you figure out, you know, you take your data and you figure out what's your failure now. It's just like the pole inspections, you know, you do 10%, you got 30% condemned, you go in and you fix them. We're getting to the point now where our failure analysis is being done, and we can start to spread out the maintenance a little bit better, so that you start to get on a cyclic plan, and you've gotten the bulk of it at least addressed, so you know where you are. The GIS is really going to help that. I'm still looking at a map for the secondary and mains that tell me that I have 30% services left over from 1893. That's not good data for me. I'm thinking that's probably not right. Mm-hmm. So this GIS is going to give us new mapping so that we know exactly how old these, that's how important this is going to be. Yeah. You want to, with one click, say, okay, how many services do I have that are older than 1970? And you want the GIS to target those areas so you can write your work orders and get them done. Mm-hmm. We're still operating on some very old mapping systems that, you know, you're basing, you know, some of the linemen and the foreman's history on where, what sections of the towns that we need to go to. And when you start to lose that knowledge by retirement, that's why it's really important that we get this GIS done quickly, and that's scheduled for this September. Double poles, it just goes back over the ownership versus the custodial. The next slide is engines. And that's why I was saying, when we talked to Verizon, we can talk to him about this too. I talked to Steve DeFerrari, our foreman, today. He's going to be setting up a meeting with Verizon. We have a lot of pole butts that we need to take out, but typically we don't do them during wintertime because the pole will break off. So we'll start that back up again in the spring, basically because the ground is frozen.
Right.
But that's not to say we haven't put in a lot of poles. This pole inspection program that we did is surfacing a lot of poles that were deemed failed. So that's why the pole numbers have gone up. But I'm seeing that Verizon is not moving them as quickly as we'd like, so we are going to probably try to meet with them next week.
Okay.
And that's kind of across all 4 towns.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
And I had been working with George Hooper on the Wilmington, if you look under Wilmington, it says non-participating third-party attacher. That's, I take that back. She's recategorized. So there's Wilmington Fiber and then Wilmington Fire, and we're working with George to see if we can't get some of that work done. I've given him some numbers on the cost, not for us to do it necessarily, but what they can do to move these things along. The town of Wilmington's fire line has now gone wireless, so there's a lot of wire that's up there that we the RMLD can't really remove that further. Mm. It's not like you set up a truck and you cut it or you transfer it. It's, you have to keep setting the truck up to remove it. So we have to work on something with the town and what we're going to do with that. The next slide is the reliability indices, and for this year to date, we're way below regional and national averages, so that's looking good. Outage causes, pretty much typical equipment, meaning fuses, wildlife, animal guards that we install, so not much change there. We are seeing some improvements with the new tree trimming program, and then that's it.
Okay. Questions for Colleen?
No.
Just a quick one was on the substation maintenance. I'm assuming that's the one in Wilmington, because there's been that little teeny parking lot's been packed with trucks for 3 weeks.
Yeah, substation 5. Well, substation 4 feeds substation 5. So in this year's capital project, we're going to be redoing the lines between that. We've done little sections, so that's a big thing. So your getaways coming out of 5 are affected. But we've been really going to town on catching up with a lot of lost maintenance on 5, because we need that to stay working and reliable till we find land and build another substation in Wilmington. And that process is going. It's not going as well as I would like, because land, we need land that's physically under the 115 lines.
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of parcels. And so we're working with 3 different owners right now to see if we can work something out. They're just not as easy as we'd like. And, you know, there's always a difference of opinion of what a parcel is worth, you know? Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, we've been really working on Station 5 to try to get that. We want that to be solid for at least 5 years.
Yeah.
If we can. I mean, if worse came to worse and we weren't able to find the land, we'd have to go back to Station 5 and build another substation there right up against the existing one. And then, like, I think Hamid has probably tried to explain it. It's almost like a heart bypass. We'd have to do that. That's not our first choice. We'd mm-hmm. like to have a nice piece of land so that if we wanted to put another generator in or batteries or something, we'd have some room to do that.
Yeah.
But so far, and we just actually, Wendy set something up with Bond, not Bond Council, but the bonding agency that the town uses, so they can explain to us exactly what we need to do, the process, whether you can bond, if you don't own the land. The people that we're talking to want it to be leased. How does the bond work or the lease? So it was a really educational meeting mm-hmm. that Wendy had set up. And so, you know, we feel like we're prepared. We just need the land.
Yeah, you get to the finish line, yeah.
So was there a specific question on 5 other than
no,
just...
No, I just said it said no hotspots found, which sounds like a good thing. But when you drive down that road, it's parking lot maybe the size of this room, and there's 12 trucks in there, and you know, between all the cars and trucks, it's amazing that many people fit in there.
Right. Well, we've actually pretty much almost redone every component in there. We really do need it to last. Yeah. I mean, it got a little shaky there for a while, but we feel confident now.
That's good.
Good. Any other comments for Colleen?
No.
Okay, Colleen, I think you're still up to some procurement requests requiring board approval.
Yes, actually, I only have one bid here.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's the distributed generator site work. And we got 51 companies that we sent the bid out. We heard back from 7 were received. And we would like the bid to be awarded to Tim Zanelli Excavating.
Okay. Correct? Okay, Phil, could you lead us with a motion?
Move that proposal 2017-35 for distributed generation work site be awarded to Tim Zanelli Excavating for $214,969 pursuant to Mass General Laws, Chapter 30, Section 39M, on the recommendation of the General Manager.
Okay, seconded.
Second.
Okay, thank you. Any discussion from the board?
No.
None appearing. We'll go for vote. All in favor?
Boom.
Okay, motion carries 4-0.
Yep.
Okay. Anything? I guess I had one item under general discussion. I don't have anything in mind, but with the budget meetings coming up in May, I guess for April, Colleen, maybe... I don't have anything in mind, but if there's anything that is of importance that you want to get any board input prior to the actual budget presentations, just, you know, let us know. We can add it to the agenda. maybe just say some time in terms of actually going through the budget, but if not, we'll just deal with it at that time.
May I ask a quick question?
Yes.
So we'll have a strategic plan. Mayhew's going to come back and do a presentation with the cost of service and some rate designs, correct?
What's the time frame of that? I guess
well,
we didn't.
Well, he presents that with the budget.
Yeah.
Because we make the rate changes or the rate increases or whatever for July 1st, effective for July 1st, and we have to file them. So logistically, though, I'm thinking that we could move forward with that, and if we're going to have a new rate structure, we're probably not going to be able to get that in for July 1st. That would be something that we can have maybe come back and do the discussion and make the decisions, and that would come afterwards. Are you seeing that differently, Jane, or if we were to come up with something?
Yeah, no, I think the plan was to get some input from the board and the CAB in terms of if there was any rate structures that they wanted to be included or changed, and shoot for a July 1st implementation. So we, if the board, if the, as a result of the budget, we know the dollars amount that we need to recover, there, we do have the flexibility of approving that in May or June, as long as the dollars. So it's like what rate class you collect them from. That's why we were tying rate changes with the budget. So I think if it's as long as the CAB and the board are willing to work with us in terms of changing the rate structure potentially, that we would still try to shoot for July 1st.
Okay, I mean, if we're talking about things that are pretty significant changes, I just wasn't sure if that was something.
Yeah, so I
just want to keep that in mind. If that's something you want to, you know, meet, you have to meet, decide, you know, roll it into the budget, and then July 1st. And if we're talking about, you know, demand changes on rates, that's
yeah. So let me.
Doesn't give us a lot of time to, I think, talk to the customers, if you will.
So why don't we? Can we break it into a couple of pieces? So, is the April board meeting sufficient time to have the presentation? Okay,
yep.
So
okay.
I think after we hear the, there's two avenues, I think. One could be, oh, wow, this is great, makes sense, and then, you know, very quickly we come to a consensus. Or it could be, this isn't ready for prime time, we want to do it right. I guess my view is it a once a year kind of, could it be done in two pieces? If we don't have a, yes, we've got a path forward, because I'm of the mindset we should be expeditious, but you know, we're talking rates, so we don't want, you know, make sure we understand exactly what the implications are, because otherwise it'll be painful for everybody. If we need more discussion or more follow-up or more analysis, what is the, and we don't see it happening with respect to the general rate increase July 1, is there any reason that a demand rate change couldn't be implemented later in the year? Is it
no,
really?
No, we can do that. You can't file rates more than 3 months from, they need a 3 month window.
Yeah.
Right.
So if we were to file rates for July 1st, we wouldn't be able to file new rates till October.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I think we go with the idea that we'd like to do that, but knowing that if we're not going to do anything, you know, precipitous.
There could be different functions. Just be, again, as we were talking, if we were going to change how we build the PPCT, you know, that would be different than the base rate revenue that we collect for operational expenses. So depending on how the studies come and what the impact is, it could occur.
Yeah, so I think the most important thing is get it on the April agenda. Let's hear it, and then we can decide if it's
When is the April meeting?
It's the 20th.
That is April 20th.
Okay, yeah. And the first order of business will be the reorg that night?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. Absolutely.
Yep. So.
And then we'll have this on the agenda, which is talked about. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
Seeing that you see you're sticking around.
Well, then we haven't had the elections yet.
No. Well, I think it's pretty much foregone conclusion.
There may be significant opposition that the write-ins
can Yes.
Okay.
I heard Mickey's busy.
Okay. Good. So anything else, Wendy, Colleen, anyone from the board? Are we good? Okay, so the meetings are listed with Thursday, April 20th, as we just discussed, and then May 10th, Wednesday, and May 11th, Thursday, we have the budgets. And a reminder, I think we've, the cadence is we will approve the operating and capital together, so we don't approve one budget and then say, oops, we known that last night, we would have done others. I think that's prudent, because the budget's a whole piece. And then CAB, do we need any CAB representation for those two meetings?
I know. Is there an issue with the budget review?
I think there was last.
There was last.
Yeah. Yeah. Do we have anyone?
And one of them will be in Wilmington.
At the high school.
At the high school, so.
Do you know which one that is?
Out of
5th,
I believe.
So I'll give the opportunity to see the new high school.
Okay. Yeah. I don't have my
My phone. I know I can't make it before April 18th.
So why don't we, Wendy, can you send a reminder out tomorrow and just see who is or isn't available? Okay. So no other discussion. Phil, would you lead us in a motion to adjourn?
I will.
This is a roll call.
You know, there is one thing I do want to mention. I did hear a report on NPR radio yesterday that the marijuana growing business in the state of Colorado uses 1.5% of the total electrical usage in the entire state. And if that comes to Massachusetts, that's going to be quite something. I just wanted to mention that.
Load growth, man.
Hopefully no one's listening to this broadcast, because I think they may draw some inappropriate conclusions about what
I just wanted to make. Okay, with that, I'll move that the board go into executive session to consider the purchase of real property and to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, and return to regular session for the sole purpose of adjournment.
Second.
Second.
Okay, a roll call vote.
Mr. Pacino, aye.
Mr. Talbot, aye.
Mr. O'Rourke, aye.
Mr. Hennessy, aye.
Okay, meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Great.